church say amen.
Amen, amen.
Yes, Jesus will fix it for you.
Yes, he will.
It is a good day to be with you to share a word from the Lord. And I'm so glad there is a word from the Lord. Reading the news this morning that Texas's infection rate for corona has had the highest rate since this thing has become, you know, affecting the U.S. And so we all need to be praying. We all need to be worshiping and thanking God. And to God be the glory for each of you under the sound of my voice. If you would open up your Bibles to 2 Chronicles chapter 11, I'll call your attention to the 13th through the 17th verse. That again is 2 Chronicles chapter 11. We'll start at the 13th and then end at the 17th verse. From the King James Version, it reads, "And the priests and the Levites that were in Israel resorted to him out of all their coasts. For the Levites left their suburbs and their possessions and came to Judea and Jerusalem. For Jeroboam and his sons had cast them off from executing the priest's office unto the Lord. And he ordained him priests for the high places and for the devils and for the calves which he had made. And after them, out of all the tribes of Israel, such as set their hearts to seek the Lord God of Israel, came to Jerusalem to sacrifice unto the Lord God of their fathers. So they strengthened the kingdom of Judea and made Rehoboam the son of Solomon strong for 3 years. For 3 years they walked in the way of David and Solomon." The Voices translation says it slightly differently. It says, "Meanwhile, Jeroboam and the ruling family in the northern kingdom prohibited the priests and Levites from performing their duties for the eternal. Jeroboam appointed his own priests to serve the religious centers of the northern kingdom, which honored false gods in forms of goats and calves. So the priests and Levites left their homes among the northern tribes. They moved to the southern kingdom in Jerusalem and supported Rehoboam as their king. Likewise, those Israelites living in the northern kingdom who were dedicated to the Eternal One, the only true God of Israel, also moved to Jerusalem to make sacrifices to the Eternal One, true God of their fathers. Those who moved south strengthened the southern kingdom with their dedication to the true God and his chosen king, Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, for 3 years. These people, they were faithful to God and followed the example of our beloved kings, David and Solomon, for 3 years." I'd like to use as a subject on this morning, real simple: walk in the ways of the saved. Real simple, just walk in the ways of the saved. Shall we go to God and pray? Heavenly Father, we say thank you right now for allowing us, God, to wake up this morning, God, with a reasonable portion of our health and strength. God, we are so grateful, God, that you have kept your hand of protection and your provisions in our life, God. God, we've been through so much in such a short time, God, it makes everything else, God, from our past look real small. But here we are, God, faithful to you, serving you, God, worshiping you, God. communicated with you, hoping, God, that you will just continue to pour your anointing on your people. In fact, God, those who are under the sound of my voice, I pray right now, Heavenly Father, God, that you just allow the Holy Spirit to connect with them, God. And as you connect with them, God, give them the strength, God, not to focus on the things of today or yesterday, God, or even the past month or this past year. But God, help them to focus on the word from on high for just a little while, God. Help them to focus on your revelation for just a little while, God. And then as your humble servant, I pray that you take me out of self. Let the Holy Spirit step in and lead the way. You are welcome, God, in this temple, God, in this sanctuary, God. In fact, God, my words, my thoughts, my speech, my mannerisms, God, that I might be used to preach to your people, to minister to your people, to uplift and encourage your people, God. Great preaching power right now. This we pray in the name of Jesus. Church said amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Walk in the ways of the saved. Most people could probably look over their life and think about some of the little white lies or the big white lies that they have told and begin to really understand this saying that I'm about to say to you. That many times in life we will look to make the wrong thing be done the right way. And it's funny because we'll manipulate people to get our will, to make things happen for us or the people who we are trying to bring along with us in this journey of life. And we'll accept what seemingly is wrong. We'll accept what seemingly should not be done. And we'll put a righteous touch to what's wrong and act like it's the right thing to do at that time. And you would believe that because we do this so often that it's acceptable and that God understands why we're doing the wrong thing seemingly the right way, while we are sugarcoating our sinful behavior and while we are trying to manipulate not only the people who are observing us, but manipulate ourselves into thinking we're still on the right path. But just because we justify for ourselves does not mean that it's justified in the sight of the Lord. It does not mean that it is correct in others' eyes, and it certainly does not mean that it's correct in the Lord's eyes. But what we have to begin to do is be real with ourselves. We truly have to be 100 with ourselves and hear our conscience speaking to ourselves and the Holy Spirit trying to arrest our attention when we're in the midst of doing wrong and living a sinful life. We must admit to ourselves that we can't continue to mask the wrong that we're doing with some form of righteousness just because we get the results that we want. And if we're true about it, real about it, 100 about it, when we look over our lives, maybe even just on yesterday, we took what was true and we made it disguised as something false just so that we can move in the direction in the way that we want. We'll make people believe that we did something that we didn't do, even the smallest things. And it seems like just because we get over on them, we think that we're getting over on God. But God is still looking at you, wondering how long is it going to take for your moral integrity, your spirituality, to step up and grow up so that you can feel the shoes that God wants you to feel. God is wondering just how long it's going to be when your conscience says, no, don't do the wrong thing, that you'll take a step towards doing the right thing and put those sinful ways behind you. God is wondering, how long is the flesh going to be weak? How long are you going to stay drinking old Similac and milk? How long are you going to stay at a point to where people still look at you as the same person today as you were on yesterday? How long is it going to be to where you keep telling yourself that things are all right for you to stay in the same situation and not change for yourself? How long will it be before you make a decision that you're going to walk in the ways of the saved? We look around at this time and we begin to look at how people are getting over during this coronavirus lockdown time. Some people are making rules for themselves, taking away things that don't belong to them for themselves, taking advantage of other people's ignorance. Now we look at the things that are going around where people are still in lying and trying to uplift themselves so that they can be big and bad in today's time. But I'm here to tell you that regardless of how you do your wrong is still wrong, and you need to get the righteousness of God. With earnest repentance, God will tell us that we're forgiven of our sin, and there is divine forgiveness for each of us. And I know what you're thinking, that sometimes it's even hard to forgive yourself when you think about the things that you've done. And I've been there. I've said some things. I've done some things that have hurt others and hurt myself, hurt the people that I love. But I understood at some point that when I get a closer walk with Jesus, when I began to bend his ear and have conversations with him, he understands exactly where I am and what I'm going through. And when I repent unto him and say, Lord, I'm sorry, and I need to do better and want to do better, I get his forgiveness, and I find it easier to let go and let God. And many of us need to begin to walk that path to where we're getting a little bit closer to God, having a little conversation more frequently with God, and we begin to understand that his forgiveness is divine and available for us, and it's the start of getting ourselves forgiven on the inside, forgiving ourselves, and it's the start of mending relationships on the outside with the people that we know, love, and admire. And when we get God's divine forgiveness, we understand that all of our sins have been purged and washed away, and it puts us on the path to pursue spiritual growth, which is needed if you're going to walk the ways of the sin. We can't be okay with just simply doing things the same way, thinking that God saved us for no purpose, just to live life. But he saved you with the intention of you being something special in the Christian body, taking your skill set and your spiritual gifts and growing those and utilizing those to begin to reach the people around you. Yet we become too comfortable being quiet and silent about our faith, being quiet and silent about our aspirations for spiritual growth. We'll say amen in the church, but won't amen anything outside the church. We're just quiet as church mice trying to get the Sunday worship over when it seems like we ought to be praising God at every step and every point of our life. But I know that you know that God is expecting more of you. I know that you know that God wants to uplift you and use you as an example of what he can do when he transforms and rebirths the lost to be saved. And I know that you know that God has been trying to get your attention. He got you all by yourself right now, and he's trying to proclaim the good news of salvation and spiritual growth to you. And this is the time that you say, Lord, I'm ready and I'm willing to do what you say, to answer the call. I'm gonna walk in the ways of the saved.
Yes, Lord.
There's a saying which goes, you don't drown by falling in the river. No, you don't drown by falling in the water. You drown by staying submerged. And when you think about that, it's so true that we don't drown in our sin just because we fall prey to sin on one day to the next. No, the problem is that we stay submerged in this place of wrong without allowing God to pull us up out. We stay submerged in our sin without a desire to come up out. And before we know it, life has gotten well out of our control. We're drowning in the midst of our sin, and it seems like we want to yell out for help, but every time we yell out for help, water is getting in our mouth and getting in our nose and washing us back in. But I'm here to tell you, when you begin to pray and say, Lord, have mercy on me, bring me out of this mess, when you begin to say to the Lord, I need thee, oh great Jehovah,
over. He'll bring you out of your mess. When you begin to testify, Lord, I know I can't make it without you. He'll begin to pull you out of that mess. And when you lift the scripture that says, call on the Lord and turn away from your sin, that he will show you the way to escape. Now is the time not to stay submerged, but now is the time to walk in the ways of the saved. First and Second Chronicles was originally written as one manuscript. It was one scroll that was broken into two books. The author is unknown and not identified within the scroll, but many who have studied this great book have come to believe that the book was written by the prophet Isaiah. I'm sorry, the prophet Ezra. When you read 1st and 2nd Chronicles, it is clear that there are parallels of historical accounts aligning with 1st and 2nd Samuel, as well as the book of 1st and 2nd Kings. Whereas Chronicles begins at the beginning of the history of humanity with Adam, and the story is then carried forward almost entirely by genealogies, a list down to the founding of the Israelite monarchy, which you'll see in 1 Chronicles 1 through 9. But the bulk of the remainder of the 1 Chronicles, after a brief account of Saul, is concerned with the reign of David. And then the next long section is concerned with David's son and successor, Solomon. And then the final part is concerned with the kingdom of Judah, which with occasional references to the kingdom of Israel. And it's in the last chapter. Judah is destroyed and the people are taken into exile where they live in Babylon. And in that final verse, the Persian king Cyrus conquers Babylon and authorizes the restoration of the temple in Jerusalem and the return of the exiles to Jerusalem so that they can serve their God. And the fact is that Chronicles identifies the historical genealogies of God's people. And it's important because it proves the presence of God in the lives of his people. It proves that God has been convinced that his people are worth saving. And it proves that God has been the author and dedicated to the salvation of his people. Because regardless of the enemy, regardless of what they went through, regardless of their location, whether they were unified or not, it seems like every time they called on the name of the Lord, they got saved. And I'm here to tell you that it doesn't matter where you are, what you're doing, what you've been through. I dare you to try calling on the name of the Lord, and I bet you that he shows up and shows out and lets you get saved. And it makes me excited just to know for myself that when you align with the will of God, he begins to move on your behalf. He begins to touch you and begins to touch your situation. And before you know it, the path is cleared. You've been strengthened and empowered to walk in the ways of the saved.
Hallelujah.
Now, I'm going to be honest with you. Following God, it ain't easy. I remember as a teenager, feeling the Spirit for myself in such a way that was undeniable. And I still tried to keep it to myself, but it was something that just rattled my body on the inside that made me get up and proclaim that I was accepting the Lord. But even from that point forward, accepting God as my personal Savior, it was difficult for me to say to the world that I've been saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. In fact, on my walk to follow God, I tried to hide him deep within, and people would tell me all the time that there's a calling
on your life. And it used to upset me sometimes because I'm trying to do my own thing. But yet I stand out like a sore red thumb. Or maybe it's just like Rudolph in front of all the other reindeers. It just seems like the Holy Spirit was blowing all around me, and it was undeniable. I felt it from the inside and continued to get confirmations on the outside. I tried to deny it on the inside, but still it got affirmations on the outside. And God wouldn't let me rest, wouldn't let me deny him, wouldn't let me ignore him, wouldn't let me walk away. But he kept the anointing and the empowerment strong from a young man to say that my boy needs to walk in the ways of the saved. He kept the anointing strong and the empowerment present so that I could resist sin and follow his ways. And slowly he began to transform me. Slowly he made me new. Slowly he built my spiritual strength. Slowly he built my knowledge. Slowly he helped me to understand that you've been called to do greater works. Greater works than these have you been called to do. And I know that I was empowered to walk in the ways of the saved.
Hallelujah.
But the daily challenge,
hallelujah,
living righteously, looking at some folk who you know and done you wrong, and saying to yourself, you are bigger than the wrong that they've done. Facing down giants in your life, and saying that my God is bigger than any giant. Taking the tools that God has given me, the skills that God has given me, whether they've been rusty or brand new, and saying I'm unafraid to go to work for the Lord. I'm trying to tell you that living righteously, it's not easy, because oftentimes we feel like we're behind the eight ball. Oftentimes we feel like we're getting second guessed. Oftentimes you know you need to be leading, but ain't nobody following. Oftentimes it seems like there's more important things to spend your time on, your money on. But when God has called you, anointed you, straightened you out, saved you, purged you, and redeemed you, you can't deny that God needs you to walk like you're saved. And so we get into our text, and we began to see how troubled society can really impact the way we live our lives. The history of the text is that when David had become king, he merged Judah and Israel to become one kingdom. But it was because of his sin that the deterioration of the community began to happen. Because some loved that king and forgave that king, but others began to hate him and wish that he was no longer in power. And when he was going through this issue, there came a beef dead in the middle of his own house. And the scripture teaches that he had to run out of his kingdom to a smaller kingdom and become someone who repented to God and got right with God. And in the midst of his transition out of power, God had already anointed Solomon to run things. And Solomon was a good king, looking to serve God and honor God. Solomon had a call on his life to be the one to erect a temple and sanctuary that God could dwell in and be pleased with. And Solomon began to do the work of the Lord, reform the people, help them to understand that God is a great God. He understands all and knows all. He's an ever-present help in your time of need. Solomon began to teach the people how they need to serve God and honor him with their lives. But some folk did not like the idea of putting so much time into the work of the Lord, and there became fractions and divisions within the work, and others refused, and they went off to another part of the kingdom. And when his reach touched over there, they went off to another part of the kingdom. And before you knew it, there were two factions, a big faction that did not want to serve the true God, and a big faction that honored God in everything that they do. And here in the text, we see the transition of leadership from Solomon to his son, and the people began to rebel. My goodness.
Yes.
What kind of parallels do we see in today's time, when we have a good president that loves people more than he loves money and tries to make the right decisions regardless of the pressure that he felt? We transition from someone who loved people and honored God and what he did, even with his shortcomings, to someone who will fake and say that he loves people and loves God, but we understand that truly what he loves is his money. And I've never seen somebody with so much try to go after so much more and destroy the lives of everybody around him. I've never seen someone who takes it upon themselves to change the rules that have governed our society for so long. I've never seen someone praise wrongdoing and backlash and push right doing down and say that there's no reason for us to even consider that. I've never seen someone in the midst of the righteous standing firm say that that's fake news. And here it is that there's an evident divide within our society where some folk want to do right and some folk want to do wrong. Here it is that there's an evident divide in our belief system where some folk want to honor God and some folk don't. And here it is in our society where love should conquer all, but it seems like hate is driving the fumes and the fuel of people's heart and emotions. And we're wondering to ourselves, what will it take for all of us to unify and come together and walk like the saved? So the scripture says, meanwhile, what Jeroboam became the ruling force of the northern kingdom. He began to flame and fuel the fires of hate and disregard for the one true God. And he began to just slowly push out the priests and Levites, who were the governing entity that kept the consciousness of the people in their society and in their kingdom. And as he pushed one out, he brought another in that was a sorcerer. As he pushed another one out, he brought another one in that practiced witchcraft. As he pushed another one out, he brought another one in that fashioned all kind of idols. As he pushed another one out, he brought another one in that just totally spoke down to and hurt the people. And before you know it, according to this scripture, the priests and the Levites, they were looking for a place to saintly serve the Lord. They were looking for a place to preach and proclaim what thus says the Lord. They were looking for a place to come together and feel the Spirit of God without having to look over their shoulders. But in the northern kingdom, it just didn't exist. So they migrated to the southern kingdom so they could serve God. And we began to look around at our communities. People used to really slow down, turn that music down, and respect the entity of the cross on the church. They dare not walk through a church's parking lot and steal while on holy grounds. They dare not expose their beer bottles, but they kept them in the brown paper bag while they were crossing a sanctified place. Their conversation it toned down and they cleaned up their words as they crossed by a sacred place.
Right, right.
And in fact, God was so good at one point in time, they would still wave and say hello instead of looking down and looking away. But in this time that we're in, where there's such a big divide, people will ramshack, do whatever they want to destroy the church, destroy the property. It just don't feel sanctified any longer. And it seems like the people who believe in God, they're beginning to look around and say, what has happened to this place that I used to know? And in fact, when it comes to the church, there's so much confusion. You start to blend in with the people outside the church. But I'm here to tell you right now that we all need to check ourselves before we wreck ourselves and begin to walk in the ways of the Lord.
That's right.
So they were in the midst of honoring false gods, honoring goats, and calves and all types of cattle. Whereas the Levites and priests, they had to find a new home, leaving the northern tribes for the southern tribes. And likewise, those Israelites living in the northern kingdom who were dedicated to the eternal one, the only true God of Israel, they also moved to Jerusalem to make sacrifices to the eternal one, the true God of their fathers. See, they understood the roots, the example of what their daddies, mamas, granddaddies, and grandmamas had done. They accept the example that if you really want to survive, you have got to find yourself getting closer to God. So they began to look at the example of David and Solomon and say, I know I need to get right. And that's when today's society recognizes that we don't have to run, but we do have to accept Christ for ourselves and begin to evangelize the gospel. We ought to evangelize the good news of Jesus Christ, his sacrifice on the cross. Well, they tried to take him out of our lives, but he fulfilled the Old Testament prophecy by saying he's greater and more powerful than death. That last blow on his side, they testified and witnessed that blood and water flowed down from his side before he took his last breath. And I thank God for the blood that washes me white as snow. In fact, I thank God for what happened next, because they wanted to party and celebrate. They put him inside a rock, put a big rock on top of that rock so nobody could disturb the body. But on that third day morning, he got up with all power in his hands. It was my God who ascended into heaven to sit at the right side of God the Father. It was my God who began to intercede for a sinner just like me. It was my God who told me that you've been empowered to walk righteously. It was my God who purged me with hyssop, cleaned up my heart, renewed my mind, and said there's a greater purpose for you. It was my God who began to move things around and shuffle the deck so that I could have a fair fighting chance. And it was my God that said, regardless of how hard it is, just turn to me and I'll show you how to resist sin.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
So you can walk in the ways of the saved.
Yes, yes, yes.
Many of us don't know the story of David and Solomon. But regardless of their sin and wrongdoing, they kept turning to God.
Yes.
And I encourage you to turn to God.
Yes, yes, yes.
They went through a 3-year transformation in this text, where they were dedicated to serving God. And I challenge you today to allow God to begin to work in your life.
Yes.
And transform you for however long it takes.
Yes.
If it takes 3 years, 3 months, 3 days, 3 hours, you are not defined by the sin of yesterday.
Praise God.
But you are defined by what God is doing in your life.
Yes.
So I offer you Christ Jesus as your Lord and Savior.
Yes.
If you would pray with me, God, we say thank you right now.
Thank you.
For helping us recognize that there's no right way to do wrong.
Yes.
And then we say thank you, God, right now. For helping us to understand that we can come out of all the mess if we just simply serve and praise you.
Yes.
So God, we accept you as our Lord and Savior.
Yes,
because we know that Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead. Now God, bless your people, empower your people, position your people, God, so that they can see your revelations and follow you.
Yes.
Let us walk the walk and talk the talk.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
If you prayed that prayer, confessing Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I believe that you're saved.
Yes.
And I praise God for you right now. Continue to connect with us via Facebook and YouTube. Like us on Facebook, join us on YouTube, and begin to share the word of God. I pray for your best in Jesus' name. Amen.